And the first thing players did was rebuild the oil tanker communications routes and tried to rebuild the world. And frankly, you know, the world rebuilt very quickly, as opposed to stayed down at the bottom for a long time. That's just a natural thrust that our design always covered. Rebuilding and eliminating chaos. People would, when we wrote adventures, it's hard to write adventures about things falling apart even more. It was always, we seemed to pick themes of rebuilding. And it doesn't, you know, Warhammer 40,000 never seems to rebuild. They just keep having a war.
If I may comment on that particular aspect of things, I think that what's happening there is a fundamental hope for the future that has been a thread in science fiction practically since its beginnings. And I think that that's really an expression of that same attitude, that same hope. And quite honestly, rapid rebuild, I don't consider unlikely if knowledge is not being destroyed. You can destroy all of the infrastructure you want, but if you have the knowledge that went into building it in the first place, it's going to be that much faster to bring it back. You may have trouble getting the resources, but you've still got the knowledge. You still know how.
As long as we retain the knowledge, I agree with you. GDW believed that chaotic environments were better role-playing environments, but never quite achieved them. That was it. We would try and tear things down, and yet people's missions were always about globally building things up, as opposed to just surviving or just getting home. It was always about building things up, which you know, I think shows an optimistic view of the staff and the designers of the company, that we would get caught up in what we wanted the world to be like, as opposed to just keeping it torn down in order to have more stupid running around shoot up stories. We're always trying for more than just that.
I throw my comment in too. Very many years of role playing. Anytime I've thrown a group of players into a situation like that, that's almost always the first thing we do is how we make it better.
Yeah.
So that's a very fundamental human thing.
There's this element, this basic thing of role playing that if you have anything except beyond the most rudimentary of role players. I mean, I have watched tedious role playing, for one. It's literally, this guy had this, and he was a tedious person. You know, I like him and we worked for us, but he did the Robin Hood archery contest. So he basically was trying to recruit a company of archers, and so he generated an entire town and then brought them all together, and over the course of weeks each of them fired 12 arrows at
those,
and just, and he enjoyed himself. It was tedious, but he had a good time. So there's that. I had another one where the players were just looting and pillaging a village, and they were terrible evil characters. And it was hard to watch as they're setting this pooch on fire and this burning this down and killing those people. Oh, and they're running around, they go up with the axes and hack and kill. But better to get that out of your system at 15 than enlist and do it at 20, you know. Because they find that it's not that much fun. They were following the rules, but there wasn't much to it. And role playing is a great way to get that out of your system. And they grew up and they were nice, ordinary people, so.
So there's hope for all of us.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, for all of us too. Okay, anything more? Yes.
Empress Way.
Oh, Empress Way.
Sorry.
You're excused now, you can.
That's twice, Eric. You're out. You got an agent here, take him out.
Where's the agent?
Right here.
Another one of those things that I have to accept as canon, it's in there, I can't just dismiss it. I find it interesting that the Empress Way was inserted into New Era, and then the system didn't really pay any attention to it. They didn't look at what it was doing. They didn't define it very well. They didn't. It was this threat they saw coming, but nobody addressed what it would really do. And I'm now forced to address those consequences. What does the wave do? Okay, I've defined what the wave does. You know. I'm going to regress on a long story here, but so we did Trillion Credits Squadron once upon a time, and somebody made an entry to that in one of our annual tournaments. To build ramps, you know, they just basically carved smooth asteroids into a ball, and they used that as nickel iron, put drives on them, bam. And it was a great concept, except we didn't have rules on what ramming did. And so there was no way to resolve it. But I took that lesson that we really want to address all the things. Our rules should address everything. So there are actually rules in T5 about ramming. You know, they're pretty cushiony ramming, but they're, nevertheless, there's rules on momentum, and we can really figure out what would happen if we rammed ships if they collided. We define what the damage would be. I tried to do that throughout Traveler 5. The wave didn't define, it was a threat, but didn't define what its damage would be. So when I had to finally address it, I needed to look at it and define it. And once you define it, then we can see what it'll do, and we can forecast its consequences. And it's destructive to the known space, to charted space, actually, pivots to known space. So I think of the wave as global warming. Everybody knows it's coming. We can even forecast what it'll do. But it doesn't affect me. It's a lie, I don't care.
How you doing there?
And that's it. And so you know, it's very easy for everybody in the golden age to just ignore it. It's not going to come for another 100 years. It doesn't matter. What are you going to do anyway? And so that's an allegory in my stories. But it is going to sweep through known space. It is going to wreak havoc everywhere. And there are some threads of trying to stop it, to ameliorate its effects, but we'll have to see what happens.
I have an aside to that, Imperial Naval Intelligence may not have been correct in what I have rumored, heard. I believe I've heard somewhere that Mega Traveler setting, Rebellion, that Strephon was out in the area that he was, that where he ended up, I forget the sector that he was in, based on the fact that he was out trying to find information about the wave.
Yeah, Project Longbow.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
All right.
That's because I'm just my game. That's why.
So, all right. Other questions?
What's up with the Zodani Corps expeditions?
Zodani.
Thank you.
What was the question, Kevin?
The Zodani Corps expeditions.
Zodani Corps expeditions.
There are several of them.
There's a whole two-sector thing down there, right?
They have been doing that for 5,000 years. sending, they are, it's almost like a cultural imperative that, of course, they coexisted with the drawing with the ancients, or the remnants of the ancients, for until recent history itself, 500 or 600 years ago. So they know, in a way that the Imperials had lost, they know that the ancients were real and were doing things. And they have a variety of artifacts that have told them about the core. And so they have been, a major thrust of Jordani society has been trying to find those answers.
Other questions?
We're winding down.
I think we are.
You know, I appreciate every, okay, one last question.
So this might be a little event outside of I have not seen any other word of that anywhere. I just don't understand what that has to do with.
So did the Hivers manipulate the assassination of Strephon?
Everybody hear that?
All of those blurbs are meant to make you think of things that will be fun to play. Search out. Each of our universes, you know, anything is possible. You can have your universe and your campaign. The Hivers can be responsible in someone else's campaign. Maybe not. And that's the whole purpose of that book. I don't think they did it.
There you have it.
Of course, that whole thing might be a Hiver manipulation to make people suspicious.
Yes.
What was your inspiration behind the Hivers?
I made the name Hivers, and then it was manipulated out beneath me into a different species than the one that I was thinking. that literally, you know, I made up names for something in a kind of a big sublight interstellar economic game we've been playing, and you know, each person, we had various societies, Earth, and Hivers were one of them. And so when I had to make up alien races, I picked the Hivers as one of them. But people said, no, that's not going to work. And so they wanted something else on staff. And so they came up with Hivers, with this kind of starfish, nonverbal people.
So what was your original idea for what Hivers?
A kind of a hive mind. You know, a lot of support. Not so much that as a telepathic single mind, many bodies.
Oh, kind of like the Formix. Arts here.
I don't know that. But the whole, you know, it's a common concept that you have many bodies, but they have a single mind that controls all of them and knows that what everybody is doing.
Yeah, the formic race of arts universe. They have hive queens that control thousands of other beings, and if the queen gets killed, all of the rest of them just kind of.
Now we have something in Traveler 5 we call the Abyssals, which is a stadium-sized mother person at the bottom of the ocean, of very deep oceans, who sends out minions of a variety of castes, you know, of warriors and workers and everything else, and they're all acting on instinct, except some of them are intelligent, but the abyssals themselves are not. So you have, if you use the bee analogy, you have them doing everything on instinct and gathering and bringing things back to the hive. But some of those bees are intelligent, because that's an important characteristic for some of what they have to do if they're going to actually build spaceships and do things. But the intelligence isn't directing them. The instinct of the mother thing is directing them. We're always trying for different things to see, because if we can create, the whole purpose of creating aliens is to isolate some aspect of humanity and reflect upon it.
That almost makes them sound like Tom Cradman's Pasleen.
And I don't know that.
The easiest way to describe the Pasleen would be they look a lot like carnivorous Kukri, but they are almost a hive mind in that some members of the species are intelligent. They are the god kings of the Pasleen, and they are essentially the directing minds of the Pasleen swarms.
And see, my thought is, my riff on that is, and I understand what you mean now, is you have some intelligence is not the peak of the species. That it's run, oh, thank you. It's run by the instinct of the hive mother person thing.
More or less, the god kings are essentially local intelligences. But
okay.
There is a period when, after the population pressure is off and they've expanded enough for now, they're essentially non-intelligent until they start exhausting the resources of the world that they're on, at which point the knowledge sort of just magically appears, and they, and individual Pasleen who know how to build ships, who know how to man the ships, who know how to use the weapons, start appearing, and so do new god kings to actually act as over control.
I'm going to have to look them up.
The series is The Legacy of the Aldenada. And I don't know how many of them are still in print, but a good place to start would be Bane Books, because that's a publisher.
Yeah, he's got good connections. So I'll grab him, and we'll grab you, and then I think...
So on a different, softer topic, after 45 years of game designing and being an author, do you have a game night at your house? Do you play any of this stuff, or is it you do this full-time and you really don't want to have anything to do with RPG or tabletop role-playing, or does...
I don't play games.
I figured.
When we were designing games at GDW, we found that after a while, you could get some benefit by sitting down with a game, a board game especially, and playing it with somebody. But there wasn't a lot of benefit. I don't want to sound uppity, we could look at a game, open the rules, scan them, and say, this are problems. That we were at that level of sophistication on how it worked. Now we could see that this game still had value, but that's what we tended to do. GDW was famous for never playtesting his game. We would just design them and publish them. Wasn't quite that bad, but it was like that. I think about games a lot. I enjoy game rules. I enjoy writing rules, and I enjoy figuring out how to make something work for people, for players. But in terms of playing myself, I don't play very much. In fact, occasionally, time I will play is when I go to my daughter's house. She and her husband are in the business. And so he sees new games all the time. He'll throw five of them on the table and say, which ones do you want to play? And we'll play one, and I'll enjoy it. It's fun. But that's what we play. It's for social.
Got one last, one final question. I think that Wayne.
Since you already started talking about the epistles, any other insights from any other T5 second survey epics races like Pegasus, Last Wolves, Wisps of the Core, that sort of thing?
You know, the purpose of that appendix is to point out that of all the things that we have in charted space, in charted space, it's just one in 100. There's a whole vast galaxy out there. And if you end up out beyond the boundaries of charted space, there's stuff you would never even imagine. You know, the world generation system is built to build new worlds. Every time you can go on, there's 2 million possibilities in that just to begin with. And then the alien generator, the Sophon creator system, can tell you things that just are, you never think of up yourself. So there's always something you can do. Just get up and generate a world, create a species that lives on it, and there is a world of possibilities just there. And that's what that whole second survey is supposed to talk about.
Mark, thank you very much. It's an honor to be to facilitate this panel with you. I hope I speak on everyone's behalf when they say thank you. Thank you for coming to TravelerCon, and thank you for being in this panel tonight. A couple of housekeeping things, and we'll get you out of here. By the way, one of which I'm not even sure Mark is aware that he's doing. So.